One year when I was in college, I had a summer job working as a recruiter for the university. And it was a really great job. You know, I traveled around with a small team of people to different church camps all over the country, and just got to spend weeks at these camps, you know, talking about the school, running workshops, building relationships with students. It was probably the best way to spend a summer. In our very first outing, we went to a camp in Dallas, Texas. And so we set out and we arrived in Dallas about mid-morning on Saturday. We met our contact person there. It was a youth minister named Rocky. And so we got out of the van, stretched because it was a long ride, and Rocky kind of showed us around the church campus and introduced us to some of the other people that we were going to be working with that week. And when all that was done, it was lunchtime. So we went out to eat. And when we got to the restaurant, Rocky said, "Let me buy for you guys." Now, the school had provided a stipend to cover all of our meal expenses and traveling expenses and lodging, and so there was no reason for Rocky to use his hard-earned money to buy a meal that wasn't going to cost us anything anyway. So we thanked him for his generosity, and we explained the situation and tried to discourage him from buying our meal, and that's when he said something that really hit me in a powerful way and that I've thought about a lot over the years. He said, "Don't rob me of the opportunity to bless you." For Rocky, serving us in this way, buying our meal, it wasn't something that he intended solely to be a blessing for us. I mean, it was, don't get me wrong. We were college students, and so the opportunity to have free food ranked up there with payday as far as highlights of the week went. But it was more than that. It wasn't just for us. It was a blessing to him. This was his way of participating in this biblical Christian community and expressing love for fellow believers. And it brought him a great deal of joy. And our depriving him of that was really a disservice to him, or at least that's how it felt. I never really thought of service that way. And as I've thought about it over the years, that statement has really continued to impress upon me the significance of serving one another and the dual blessing that it can be. This morning, we're going to continue a series that we started several weeks ago called Awkward, Christian Community Socially Distanced. You know, when we look through the New Testament and we look at the kind of faith community that God has in mind for us, it's really a remarkable thing. You know, it's this group of people where we find belonging and mutual encouragement and mutual development and mutual love for one another. But when we look at some of the specific instructions for how we're to live in this biblical Christian community, some of them seem a little awkward, just to be honest, at least by our cultural standings. For example, we're told in one place to wash one another's feet. That's weird. I mean, it just is. It's unusual. Now, we're going to find this morning as we look through that command that the idea of washing people's feet really is just a command to humbly serve one another. But even that can be a little uncomfortable at times, partially because we don't fully understand what service is, and partially because we don't fully appreciate the lesson that Rocky was trying to teach me, that service can be a dual blessing that is just as gratifying and satisfying to myself as it is to the one I'm serving. This morning, as we dive into this topic of service and how it fits into our life together, I want to encourage you to open up your Bibles to the book of John, chapter 13. John is the fourth book in the New Testament. If you're not familiar, it's Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. We're going to be in chapter 13. And this is a story out of the life of Jesus. If you have your Bible, open up there. Alternatively, if you have the FCC Monmouth app downloaded on your mobile device, you can just click the Sunday button in the bottom right-hand corner, and you'll find a button for sermon notes. It has our passage already pulled up and broken down for us to digest and work through today. So John 13, once again, is where we're going to be. And as we read through this event from Jesus' life, we're going to see him wash people's feet. Now, like we said, that's unusual. So as we see him do this, as we read this story, I want you to be asking yourself the question, why? Why does Jesus engage in this awkward act of service? Let's look at the story and get into it. It's John chapter 13, verse 1. It says, "It was just before the Passover festival. Jesus knew that the hour had come for him to leave this world, and go to the Father. And having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The evening meal was in progress, and the devil had already prompted Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot, to betray Jesus. Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power, and that he had come from God and was returning to God. So he got up from the meal, took off his outer clothing, and wrapped a towel around his waist. And after that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet drying them with the towel that was wrapped around him. So just to understand what's happening in this little scene that we see, Jesus, on the last night of his earthly life before his execution, is celebrating the Passover meal with his disciples, his friends. And as they're eating the meal, at some point in the evening, Jesus gets up from the table, takes off his outer garment, he's still got his undergarments on, he wraps a towel around his waist, he grabs a towel and a basin, and he just begins washing the disciples' feet, one by one, working his way around the table. Now, this is a really awkward scene, but not for the reasons maybe that you're thinking. You know, we shouldn't imagine Jesus on his hands and knees crawling under the table and between people's legs, just like sneak attacking people's toes with soapy water. That's not what this is. The tables in this culture, they were low tables. They didn't sit up high where you needed a chair. And so most people would lounge on the ground around the table. They'd kind of prop themselves on their elbow and kick their feet kind of out and behind them. They kind of reclined. And so all their feet are on the outside of the table, and Jesus is just kind of walking around the outside of the circle in front of everybody in plain view. And so that's not really the weird part, Jesus, you know, washing feet. Really, the awkwardness stems from a social nature here, the social context at play. You see, people in this ancient world, they wore sandals everywhere. And as they walked through their day and through the market streets and through their homes and their fields, the same thing that happens to us when we wear sandals happened to them. Their feet got really nasty. And so when somebody entered a home, it was considered a very hospitable thing to do to have their feet washed or to wash the feet of your guests. And this would be the job of the servants of the household. Now, even among servants, this was gross. Nobody wanted to do it. And so it usually fell to the lowest ranking person in the servants' ranks to wash these feet. It's kind of the way that that the new guy at work gets stuck doing all the stuff that nobody else wants to do. That's really what happened here. So bring it back to Jesus and what we just read. Jesus is certainly not the lowest ranking person in this room. In fact, he's their teacher. He's their leader. He's probably the highest ranking person in this room. And that's what makes this awkward. Numero uno is walking around the table doing the job of this really lowly slave. If the roles should have been reversed. The disciples should have been washing Jesus' feet. They should have been serving him. But instead, this is like a university president going and scrubbing dormitory toilets to get them clean. You know, the social order is all mixed up here. And it's uncomfortable for these disciples to see Jesus doing this. In fact, even Peter, if we were to keep reading, he says, "No, Jesus, don't wash my feet. I should be washing your feet." So it asks the question, why? Why is Jesus doing this? Why is he engaging in this lowly, somewhat awkward act of service? Well, he tells us, if we keep reading, skip down a little bit to verse 12. It goes like this. When he had finished washing their feet, he put on his clothes and he returned to his place. "Do you understand what I've done for you?" he asked them. The answer is obviously no. I mean, we're asking the same question. Jesus, why are you doing this? He says, "You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that's what I am. Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet. I've set you an example that you should do, just as I have done for you. Very truly, I tell you, no servant is greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. Now that you know these things, you'll be blessed if you do them." So we read Jesus' words here, and he tells us, the reason that I've done this for you disciples, and by extension, you and I, I'm trying to set an example for you. I'm trying to model something that I intend for you to follow. In short, what Jesus is doing is demonstrating to them and to us today the kind of people, not just individuals, but the kind of community he desires for us to be. He wants us to be a people that serve one another. That's really what this is about. Now, maybe it would have been easier if Jesus just came out and said that, "Hey guys, I want you to serve one another." And maybe he should have even just commanded us with his authority to say, "I command you to serve one another in love." But here's the thing. If Jesus had done that, it kind of sends a mixed message. You know, to command somebody with authority that they must serve, it seems a little hypocritical in some ways. It's kind of like, you know, coming home and spanking your kid because they hit somebody on the playground. You know, we don't hit, whack. There's a mixed message in there, right? Admittedly. And in other ways, this is kind of like the difference between authoritarian leaders and servant leaders. You know, an authoritarian leader is somebody, and maybe managers or business owners operate this way sometimes, somebody that sees their authority as something to be wielded. You know, I say you do this thing and you do it. I say jump and you say how high. And in a business context, sometimes it looks like squeezing your employees, trying to get as much productivity out of them as you can, like they're an orange that you're juicing or something. Servant leadership looks a little different. A guy named Lee Cockrell, he's a great example of this. He's the former vice president of operations of Disney World. And he talks about servant leadership in a lot of different contexts. But in his blog, this is what he writes about his theory. He says, I wanted to create an environment where people wanted to come to work every day. If I created a place where everyone mattered and they knew that they mattered, people would look forward to coming to work and they would take care of the guests. Listen to this part. It wasn't about me. It was about the cast members. That's what they call employees at Disney World. I was there to serve them so they could serve the guests. Lee seems to be operating under this understanding that what you give is what you can expect to receive in return. In other words, he gave his employees a model of what service looked like and how he served them. And in return, he received this culture of service in which the guests at his park benefited. This is exactly what Jesus is doing. He has given us this tremendous demonstration of service. And not just in this moment, by the way. This in chapter 14, where he washes feet. It is certainly an incredible demonstration of what it means to serve one another. But this is just the beginning. Not 24 hours from this point, Jesus is going to serve us in a huge, huge way. He's going to bear a cross. And through his death on the cross, he's not just going to wash our feet. He's going to wash our very existence clean through his blood. And he's going to take our sin upon himself. And he's going to die our death. And in exchange, he's going to give us his innocence and his righteousness before God. And he's going to give us the kind of life that he earned, this eternal existence with God. It's this great exchange, this service that he does for us. That's what he gives, this phenomenal example of servanthood. So the question then becomes, what is he going to receive in return? What are we going to give him? Or asked maybe a slightly different way, I guess the question becomes, what does it say about us when we serve one another in Christian community? I mean, that's the whole point of why Jesus sets this example in chapter 14. He's trying to cultivate this culture of servanthood among his people. So what does it say about us when we engage in that, and when we practice in serving one another in biblical Christian community? Well, if I could borrow from our passage again, in verse 14, Jesus says, you call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that's what I am. Those two terms that we oftentimes ascribe to Jesus in our lives are hugely significant. And really, they go a long way in answering the question we just asked. When we serve one another in biblical Christian community, I think it goes a long way in saying that Jesus really is our Lord. He really is the one whom we bow our knee to and whose word we follow and whose authority we honor with our lives. Now, to make Jesus Lord doesn't just mean he's, you know, this great guy that we ascribe greatness to. To be Lord is to carry absolute, unwavering authority over something. And that's an idea that honestly we're kind of unfamiliar with in the United States. One of the great aspects of our government and the way that it's structured here is that we choose our leaders. You know, in a lot of ways, they're supposed to be public servants. And if we become dissatisfied with their service, then we can elect different officials. In other words, nobody is permanent. Nobody's authority is absolute and irrevocable. You know, but that's not what lordship is. Lordship is unwavering, irrevocable, absolute authority over us and our lives and our conduct. That's really unfamiliar territory for us. In fact, that's kind of one of the reasons the United States was formed, was to get away from that king, monarch, lord kind of figure. You know, so maybe this idea is, it kind of causes us to bristle a little bit, but that's absolutely what it means for Jesus to be our Lord. You know, it means that his word is absolute. So when he says, I've set you an example that you should do, just as I have done for you. It's not really the kind of thing we get to just brush aside if he is Lord, if he has this absolute, unwavering, irrevocable authority over our being. In fact, he's kind of getting at that idea in verse 17, when he says, no servant is greater than his master. You've probably seen this bit in different television shows and movies and things, but it's, you know, a very common thing where you have these employees that are extreme suck-ups that try to get on the boss's good side, and they do that by imitating the boss. You know, if the boss is into golf, then they fall over themselves to get really enthusiastic about golf, and they show up in those ridiculous old school golfing clothes. Or if the boss is really into wine, they go and they just dive headfirst into the world of wine tasting and so on. You know, it's that comedic thing that if it's good enough for the boss, it's good enough for me. And really, that's kind of the idea at work here. If it's good enough for our Lord, if service wasn't beneath him, then who am I to deny that or exclude myself from that calling? Now, when Jesus is our Lord, it means that we honor his command with everything that we are. And if he is one that washed feet and served, well, then who are we to say no? A phenomenal example of what it means to follow Jesus as Lord in this aspect comes to us from an unexpected place. There's a guy named Albert Schweitzer. He's a 19th century theologian. And you might say, well, he was a theologian. Of course he did what Jesus asked. During this time period, you'd be surprised at how many people didn't actually believe a lot about Jesus. So we're not real sure where Schweitzer stood as far as Jesus' divinity or salvation or things like that. One thing that is very clear, though, he understood Jesus' words and his call to be a Lord, and that the lordship of Jesus meant that Schweitzer had to serve. You know, among his many accolades, you know, he was this theologian, he held different academic posts. He was also a renowned concert organist. And he would use much of his proceeds to build a hospital in Africa to serve the poor. And in fact, he became so enamored and so impassioned with this service that he used some of his proceeds to put himself through medical school, to train as a doctor with the intention of going to Africa to work at his hospital. Now, that's when a war broke out, and he and his wife actually ended up in prison in an internment camp. And when they got out, there were some other things that happened. And so Albert was delayed for a number of years, but he spent his time writing, and he spent his time playing organ and raising money. And finally, in 1924, he and his wife made the move to Africa, and they lived out the rest of their days serving in that hospital. And he would use the money that he collected from royalties and the money that he made through personal appearances and really his fortune, he would pour into this hospital, expanding it to 70 buildings capable of treating over 500 people at the same time. It's this tremendous accomplishment. He used his whole life, his whole career, his fame, most of his fortune. He poured all of it into this service of the poor in this continent. And he didn't do this just because of some inherent altruism or just because he was such a good guy. No, Albert had been shaped by the call of Jesus. His father, grandfather, they were both ministers in the church. Albert was raised in church. He was incredibly familiar with the calls of Jesus and what it meant to call him Lord and to serve. And in fact, in one of his most famous books, Albert Schweitzer, he writes, "The demands of Jesus are difficult because they require us to do something extraordinary. And at the same time, he asks us to regard these acts of goodness as something usual, ordinary." In other words, in the context of our subject, when Jesus calls us to serve, he doesn't have something in mind that is typical or comfortable. And yet, when he calls us to this sometimes awkward act of service, he calls us to embrace it to such an extent that it becomes natural to us. It's our new normal. You might say it's just part of who we are as a people. And really, that brings us to the second part of our answer. You know, we asked, what does it say about us when we serve one another in this biblical Christian community? It means that Jesus is our Lord, but it also fulfills the second part of what Jesus says in John 14. It means that Jesus really is our teacher. You know, he says, "You call me teacher and Lord," and rightfully so. Now, when Jesus says teacher, we might have a different image in our mind than what he intends. You know, when we hear that word, we oftentimes might think of the person who spends hours a day with our children in the classroom and teaches curriculum and passes down information and so on. And right now, there are a lot of parents who are homeschooling their kids who have a newfound appreciation for these people in their lives. To teach in this context is an incredibly significant thing. But when Jesus talks about a teacher, he has something even a little more demanding in mind. Now remember, this is an ancient Jewish culture, so when we hear teacher, we ought to be thinking rabbi. And when disciples learned from a rabbi, they did learn information, and information was transmitted to them, but it was more than that. They also would follow their rabbi around the marketplace, and they would observe him in social gatherings and situations. They might even spend time at his home, because the goal of a disciple wasn't just to learn information from their teacher. It was to learn how to live life well. In other words, they didn't want to just learn facts and theories and interpretations. They wanted to learn a lifestyle. That's what it meant to follow a teacher. So when Jesus says that I, your Lord and teacher, have set you an example that you should do just as I have done for you, that again doesn't really sound like the kind of thing we get to brush off if this is the person we've dedicated our lives to following and modeling ourselves after. In fact, it kind of sounds like this intense call to do likewise, right? If Jesus really is our teacher, then we serve one another. In a lot of ways, it kind of reminds me of the relationship between a parent and a child. You know, right now, my three-year-old son, he's learning the ABCs. And so, you know, we're working on this in our house, and he's learning the song, and we are passing information on to him, but he's also learning how to live life from us. And unfortunately, he's not always learning how to live life well. His phrase right now that he likes to use when he gets frustrated is, "Oh, come on!" And he started saying this, and my wife and I were like, well, where did he pick this up at? My wife knew, I didn't, because the dots hadn't connected yet. But one day we were in the bathroom and we were brushing his teeth. I dropped a toothbrush. I got toothpaste all over the floor. I said, oh, come on. And that's when the light bulb came on in my head and I realized, oh, he got that from me. You know, the same way that children learn how to live from their parents is how students or disciples learn to live from their master. And if Jesus is our Lord, if he is our teacher, and this is the example that he sets, this lifestyle of service, then once again, who are we to deny that, to exclude ourselves from that calling? No, this is to be who we are, because it's who he was. Again, in some ways, it makes me think of this Chinese man. He was 2 years old at the time. When he, as a child, he fell off the table, he hit his head, and he fell into a coma. His name was Hu Jinchuan. And so he was in this coma. A couple days later, he woke up, but he wasn't able to communicate or express anything, and he couldn't move. So obviously his mother was very distraught over his situation, but just compounding this whole ordeal was the fact that she couldn't afford any sort of care facility for him to stay in. And so she took him home, and she did her best to take care of him herself. Now, because he couldn't move, he just laid in bed, and he started to develop bed sores. And so it became clear to this mother that she was going to have to move her child quite often, and so she began just carrying him around on her back. Now, when this story was reported, or when I first heard it, this woman was 65 years old and weighed 90 pounds. And at that time, she continued to carry around her fully grown son of 180 pounds day after day after day. And you might wonder, well, why would she do that? Well, it's because she loved him. And she wanted to provide a life for him and to give him dignity and to lift him up, literally in this case. And so she served him. Not because some doctor ordered her to or because it was mandated by the government. No, she served him because that's what you do when you love somebody. And she served him so fervently and so naturally that this became part of who she was. This was just how she lived. It was part of her DNA. And that's the extent to which service is to be ground into our very being as people who follow Jesus and who call him teacher and Lord. We serve because he served. So that brings us to the application part of our time together this morning. You know, we've already heard of how Jesus served and the tremendous example that he set. And we've heard how you and I as a biblical Christian community are to serve as Jesus, if Jesus really is our Lord and our teacher. So I guess the natural question is, how? How do we go about serving each other in this way in biblical Christian community, especially at a time when we're socially distanced and we can't even really be in the same room together? And really, the answer isn't difficult. It actually comes in the first verse of our story in our passage. If we want to look back at John chapter 13, verse 1, this is the last sentence in that paragraph. It says, "Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end." He loved them fully. He loved them completely. He loved them all the way up to the end. Any of those are accurate translations. This is the context in which Jesus serves. It's his love. And yes, he wants to set this example. And yes, he wants to model what he desires this biblical Christian community to look like after his work is finished. But at the end of the day, this is his last night on earth with these disciples. And he just wants to find another way to express his love for his friends. So he serves them. And that's really the answer. How do we express this service? How does the service manifest today in the socially distanced context? Well, we just love each other, or at least act like we love each other. So do what loving people do. And one of the loving things that people do for one another is they pray for one another. That's a really easy thing that we all can do. You know, each week we send out an email to our email list at church, and it has prayer requests on it. And some of them are prayers because of hardships. Some of them are praises because of the work of God in people's lives. But it goes out every week. And so if you want to begin serving one another in biblical Christian community, this is a fantastic place to start. You know, maybe you don't have the means to serve in a lot of other ways. Maybe you don't have the time, the opportunity, the energy, the skill, whatever. Anybody can pray. And that means that everybody has the opportunity to serve one another in this way. Another thing that people do when they love and they care about one another is that they take care of one another. They help meet each other's needs. And there's plenty of opportunity for that right now as we are socially distanced. You know, we've been talking a lot lately about how church is going to look when we're finally allowed to come back together, you know, gathered in person in the building. And as much as I wish I could say, you know, day one, as soon as we're allowed, everything goes back to normal and people flood in, that's just not going to be the case. And people will be disappointed by that. But honestly, this is one way that we're trying to lovingly serve people in our congregation by maybe staggering out what, bringing everybody back. We don't have all the details worked out yet, but we just want to make sure that we take care of those who are vulnerable in our congregation. And so as those details become more solidified, we'll be sure and pass those on to you in all of our communication channels. But we don't have to wait until that time to take care of one another. We can do that right now. There are a lot of people that really should not be out in public right now because of health reasons, because they're vulnerable. And so one of the things that we offer through our church is this grocery pickup program where you just call in and say, hey, would somebody go to the store and get this for me? Or would somebody go pick up my medicine from the pharmacy? And we have a number of people that have already volunteered to be a part of that program. And if you'd like to join that list, just send us a message through Facebook Messenger and let us know. We'll put you on the list. And I would say this too, if you're one of those people who maybe because of a health reason should not be out right now, please, please don't feel like you're inconveniencing anybody by calling and asking for help. In fact, when you refuse to call in, you rob us of the chance to bless you. We want to do this. We want to serve because we love you. Now, another thing that we can do to serve one another at this time, you know, we right now together, we have internet access and we can navigate the digital world fairly easily and gather together. But not everybody in our congregation has that ability or skill. There are some who still don't have internet access, or there are some that just really struggle to navigate the digital world. And maybe something that we can do for them right now is to put a DVD of messages together. Pack it together with some communion packets and deliver that to their homes. We don't know who these people are, but you do. So if you know of somebody who is in that situation, just let us know. We'll gladly put together a disc of messages so that they can be a part of this time together, so they can break bread and partake of the cup and the loaf with us. You know, it'd be a huge, huge blessing to their spiritual walk to have that. And to that end, you know, maybe one of the best things we could do during this time is just reach out and make contact with people. I've been doing that a lot this week, and there's this common theme that shows up in my conversations. People are lonely. A lot of times they're bored too, but people are lonely right now because of this distancing that we have to go through. So maybe one of the best services that we could offer is a phone call to say, hey, how you doing? Or to send a card in the mail to say, we didn't forget about you and we miss you. Or maybe send them a text message, or you know, there's all kinds of ways that we can reach out and let people know that they matter. That's a tremendous service during this time where we're socially distanced. Now, all of these things that I've recommended or suggested, they're just that, they're suggestions. There's no limit to how we can serve one another. And I would encourage each and every one of us this week to find some way to serve one another in this faith community and in this faith family. Because that's who we are and what we do. We are a biblical Christian community that loves one another through service. Now, maybe that idea makes you a little uncomfortable. Maybe the idea of stepping out and serving somebody in this way, it feels a little awkward to you. But I would ask you this, what if taking this step to serve somebody in this community, what if that's your next step? And looking a little bit more like your Lord and your teacher, Jesus. And what if this small act of kindness and service, you know, whether it's a phone call or dropping off a DVD or helping somebody get some groceries, what if that's the act of kindness that just turns somebody's whole week around and means so much to them? Wouldn't it be awesome to be a part of that? So here's the wrap up this morning, the takeaway point. Don't rob yourself of the opportunity to bless somebody else and be blessed in the process. Be like your teacher, be like your Lord, be like Jesus, and serve one another. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for today, and we thank you for how you have served us by providing for us your Son, by laying down his life on a cross and giving us this gift of righteousness and holiness and life. And I pray that we would learn from this example of foot washing and this example of the cross, and that we ourselves would go out and would humbly serve. And at times, it can be a little awkward. It can be a little uncomfortable. But Father, it can also make all the difference in the world to somebody. And it can humble us and make us look a little bit more like Jesus. And so I ask that boldly and in faith, we would go out and we would serve. And that we would love because of how you've loved us. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.